Welcome to this year's Camp Meeting 2017. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of Him who hath called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. 1 Peter 2:9. May you all be blessed.
And we thank our Heavenly Father that we can be here this afternoon. Brothers and sisters, we are living in a time when every wind of doctrine is blowing through the hallways of God's denominated people. And believe you me, those winds of doctrine are not confined to the organizational structure. They blow wherever God's people assemble. And I would like us to look this morning, as we proceed with our study, at some of the issues that we face as God's denominated people. What is it that has caused some of our most precious brothers and sisters to assimilate a teaching that is causing a great deal of division among what is loosely termed among us as Adventists the independent ministries? I have a deep sympathy and an empathy for the people who have evolved this doctrine, and I would like to look at that motivation for a moment this afternoon. The doctrine I'm going to give a name to, which is probably not familiar to everybody, and that is the Binitarian teaching. Most of us would normally classify it as Arian. But the Binitarian teaching devolves the Godhead down to two persons, relegates the third person of the Godhead to exist merely as an emanation of force or power proceeding from Christ and from the Father, and in some cases designates the Holy Spirit as the person of Christ and the person of God, but not as a separate, distinct entity with intelligence and feeling on his own part. And the reason being is these dear folk have seen where the invidious teachings that have been adopted by Adventism on the Trinity are leading to. I'd like to look at us to look at those teachings for a moment. You see, the Trinitarian teaching does not revolve around the number three, as these folks seem to have thought it does. Trinitarian teaching revolves around one fundamental error, which destroys both the plan of salvation and the sanctuary doctrine. It teaches, and by the way, this is now a second fundamental belief in Adventism today, according to 28 Fundamentals. It teaches that God is an indivisible essence manifested in three different ways. If you take nothing from this meeting this afternoon, if you take this one thing, that to teach that God is an indivisible essence or substance, then if that is grasped and held onto, you will have learned why we can never be Trinitarian. Because this is what happens when you do believe that. Firstly, take it in a natural progression of thought. If Christ is indivisible from the Father, What killed Christ on the cross? Separation from his Father, but if he's indivisible from his Father, how did separation take place? I beg your pardon? The sins of the world weighed upon him, but it was not the cross that killed Jesus. It was his Father turning from him. It was separation from his Father that broke the heart of the Son of God. If the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are an indivisible substance or essence, then when Christ died on the cross, the Christ modality, which was indivisible from the Father, had to return to the Father. And only a human body that was inhabited for 33 and a half years died on the cross. Immediately, such a notion lowers the law of God to the level of humanity. Because only a human body is now paying the penalty of the law. If you lower the law of God to the level of humanity, that justifies the Pope from declaring himself as God's representative on earth as being in a position to change the law. It's been brought down to his level. And this justifies the elimination of the second commandment and the modification of the fourth. If Christ was indivisible from the Father and returned to the Father at the crucifixion, immediately you have just done away with his mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary, because you cannot have one modality, manifestation, call it what you will, mediating with itself. And the Roman Church recognized this after the 4th century AD when they concocted the doctrine of the Trinity at the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD. They recognized this fact and immediately stepped forward and proclaimed themselves our mediator. The Pope is now our mediator. The saints are now our mediator. Mary is now co-mediatrix. And the priest who offers up the sacrifice of the Mass at the service of the Mass is mediating on behalf of the people. And so therefore the Roman Church steps into the role of mediator. And Christ is sidelined. Can we see that that doctrine has immediately eliminated the fundamental teaching of Adventism? What is the fundamental undergirding doctrine of Adventism? The sanctuary. If Christ is not our mediator, then what on earth are we preaching? Now, these folk have recognized that fact. And they have seen that Trinitarianism is an abomination. And so they returned to the writings of the pioneers who were anti-Trinitarian. And they have found among the writings of the pioneers the doctrine of binitarianism, which teaches that there are only two persons in the Godhead, that Christ was plucked from the bosom of the Father at some point in infinity, and also they relegate the Holy Spirit to simply being God the Father and God the Son's omnipresence and power emanating from them both. Now, some of our pioneers believed and taught that. Where had they come out of? They had come out of the various denominations of Christendom. And, you know, did God's messenger have baggage when she came out of Methodism? She did. But God progressively led her away from the baggage that she had when she came into the movement started by William Miller. And God has been doing the same with each and every one of his people from that time when the loud cry was being given here in the 1840s that Christ was about to come. And unfortunately, this baggage, as some of you have heard this morning in Pastor Nuna's discourse, came from various sources. We need to see why it is baggage that we have to jettison. And as we go through these studies, I pray the Lord that He will show us why it is as dangerous as Trinitarianism. I get a lot of correspondence from many of the various ministries that teach this binitarian doctrine. I'll just give you a quick rundown of some of the ministries that are giving this, and of course these are places from which I have received a great deal of literature and a great deal of correspondence as well. There's the Present Truth Ministries of Dr. Linford Beachy in Kansas, Oklahoma. There's Gary H. Strong from the Voice of Reformation Publications in Louisville, Kentucky. There's Alan Stump of Smyrna Gospel Ministries from Welsh, West Virginia. David Clayton, who publishes also through Smyrna Gospel Ministries. Restoration Ministries of Manchester, Jamaica in the West Indies. EMV Shamar Publishers of Kerryong, Australia. Coming Home Publishers of Higdon, Alabama. Richard Stratton of Philadelphia Press, Florence, Colorado. Dr. Gary Holquist, Talking Rock Sabbath Chapel from Talking Rock, Georgia. Margareta Tierney, I hope I pronounced that correctly, from Remnant Messages in Ararat, Australia. Fountain Publishers from Jasper, Georgia. Dr. Herbert Cole, I have no address information for him as yet. I was handed material taken by somebody who sat in one of his seminars, and they wrote down what he was teaching at the seminar, and that was sent on to me by Pastor John. And then there's a Wilbur Hargraves of Seal, Alabama, Terry Hill of the United Kingdom, Timothy M. Youngblood of Nixa, Missouri, and then there's those of you who surf the web. There's a Daniel Misa of Pioneer Publications from Kalispell, Montana. Folk, this that I'm delivering to you today is a response to a letter from one of these gentlemen, and that is from Wilbur Hargreaves. I have come to like and respect this man over the period of time that I've been corresponding with him, which is well over a year and a half now. However, the last letter that he sent me distressed me the most, and this is the response to him. On page 5 of Wilbur Hargreaves' letter, dated September the 11th of 2015, he wrote, and I quote, "The only heavenly trio I've ever read about in the Bible, or the Spirit of Prophecy, is Jehovah, Michael, and Lucifer, before Lucifer's fall." Now, brothers and sisters, that sounds pretty horrendous, doesn't it? But believe you me, there's a reason why this man says this, but it's wrong. After reading this appalling statement, I was deeply shocked and hurt, pained, that his incorrect theology had inveigled him into so dangerous a position of faith. The above quoted postulation from his pen skirts breathtakingly close to the unforgivable sin of declaring the Holy Spirit, the mighty third person of the Godhead, to be Lucifer. Now, Christ warned against this in the scriptures that we are all very familiar with. It's found in Matthew, the 12th chapter, verses 22 through 32. Then was brought unto him one possessed of a devil, blind and dumb, and he healed him, insomuch that the blind and dumb both spake and saw. All the people were amazed and said, Is not this the son of David? The one that they'd been taught to expect, who could do such miracles? And when the Pharisees heard it, they said, This fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of devils. And Jesus knew their thoughts, and said unto them, Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And if Satan cast out Satan, he's divided against himself. How shall then his kingdom stand? And if I, by Beelzebub, cast out devils, by whom do your children cast them out? Therefore they shall be your judges. Now I want us to notice something. Beelzebub. We know is another name for who? Satan. Is Satan a separate and distinct individual?
Yes.
Are the fallen angels that were cast out of heaven with him separate and distinct individuals?
Yes.
They are. And tell me something. Where do they dwell before we are converted? Sorry? Every child born into this world is born with what we call a carnal heart. Is that not right? What does the Bible describe the carnal heart as being? It is enmity against God. It is not subject to his law, neither indeed can be. Why? Because the carnal heart or mind is controlled by one of the minions of hell. And they are all separate and distinct individuals. But what did God create this body to be a temple of? The Holy Spirit. And yet we will acknowledge that we can be inhabited by a separate and distinct individual from hell. And then we don't want to acknowledge that the Holy Spirit is a separate and distinct individual who can inhabit us. Let us proceed. Verse 28. Christ went on to say, But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you. Or else, how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house? He that is not with me in what I'm telling you now is against me. And he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit shall not be forgiven unto men. And to start skirting into a theology that begins to equate the third person of the heavenly trio with Lucifer is skating dangerously close to the condemnation contained in Christ's words here. Verse 32. And whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come after my Father recreates it. God's messenger, under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, warns against this, as found in Prophets, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 404, paragraphs 4 through 405 to paragraph 1. And I quote, "They dared to attribute his," that is God's, "judgments to Satan, declaring that through the power of the evil one, Moses and Aaron had caused the death of good and holy men." You remember when the earth swallowed up and Korah, Dathan, and Abiram all went down? The people turned around and they accused Moses and Aaron of having destroyed the Lord's servants. Remember that? Well, it was this act that sealed their doom. They had committed the sin against the Holy Spirit, a sin by which man's heart is effectually hardened against the influence of divine grace. "Whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man," said Christ, "it shall be forgiven him. But whoso speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him." And there we find God's messenger quoting Matthew 12, 32. "These words were spoken by our Savior when the gracious works which he had performed through the power of God were attributed by the Jews to Beelzebub." How was the power of God administered to Jesus? It was administered to Jesus through an agent. And the agent we know as the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, along with the heavenly angels, administer to the entire created universe, while God is in his high and holy place. Let us proceed with this quote. "These words were spoken by our Savior when the gracious works which he had performed through the power of God were attributed by the Jews to Beelzebub." It is through the agency of the Holy Spirit that God communicates with man. And those who deliberately reject this agency as satanic have cut off the channel of communication between the soul and heaven. God works by the manifestation of his Spirit to reprove and convict the sinner. And if the Spirit's work is finally rejected, there is no more that God can do for the soul. Why? Because God has to minister to us through an agency. There are two divine agents through whom God administers to fallen humanity: through the Son and through the Holy Spirit. God the Father cannot come into direct communication with us without his presence destroying us. If God's messenger intended to imply that God and his Spirit are one and the same person, the above statement would have been worded differently. God's messenger is clearly describing the work of the Holy Spirit in this context as the work of the Father's agent, not as the Father's person, and certainly not as his, that is Christ's, own person, but as the Father's agent in this context. After reading Brother Wilbur's words, which incidentally exactly echo those of a Dr. Herb Cole, against whose vagaries of interpretation and theology I have also had to write, I was so dismayed that I had to put his assertions aside for a season. I was so distressed because I thought that by the grace of God I was starting to get through to this man with the responses that I was sending him through the mail. But this last letter of his disturbed me greatly. However, let us address the opening assertion of this letter that we're discussing. He opened by quoting from Paul's greeting that opens Paul's epistles. And the greeting runs as follows. Grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. He then went on to make the point that this greeting found in Scripture excludes any third being. Okay? The truth is, he had just missed the message of Paul's greeting. Permit me to explain. Paul is writing to fellow citizens of this demon-usurped planet. There is a God of this world who permits no peace to those who oppose his control. Grace, which we know is unmerited favor, and peace, that's the peace that passeth all understanding, as it is a peace that we can have even amidst all the vicissitudes of this life, can only be imparted from the Father and from the Son, who are and were at the time of Paul's writing in their high and holy place. And it can only therefore be imparted through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. At this point, Christ had already returned to heaven. This is in AD 31 when Christ returned. And has by that time already sent and also has already requested his Father to send our other Comforter, the Holy Spirit, who acquaints us with all truth. The Holy Spirit, whose work in us and for us makes effectual Christ's sacrifice and Christ's mediation for us. Let us read in the Desire of Ages, page 671, paragraph 2. And you'll see I keep stressing certain points. The Spirit was to be given as a regenerating agent. An agent is a separate and distinct entity from the one who he or she is acting as the agent of. In this case, it's very much a he. The Holy Spirit is not feminine, he's masculine. And he is the regenerating agent. And without this, without the work of the Holy Spirit as the regenerating agent, the sacrifice of Christ would have been of no avail. You know, just to pause there for a moment, why? We will come in our studies to see that the Holy Spirit has a nature that we cannot conceive of. How do you conceive of an individual with intelligence and feeling who is in every place in the entire created universe simultaneously, administering the sustaining power of God to the entire universe? How do you conceive of a being who's everywhere? We'll come to that point again. The power of evil had been strengthening for centuries, and the submission of men to the satanic captivity was amazing. Sin could be resisted and overcome only through the mighty agency of the third person of the Godhead. That is plain American English that God's messenger conveyed to us, and we do not have to rest or twist these words to mean other than what they are telling us. This mighty third person of the Godhead who would come with no modified energy but in the fullness of divine power, because he administers God's power. It is the Spirit that makes effectual what has been wrought out by the world's Redeemer. It is by the Spirit that the heart is made pure. Through the Spirit, the believer becomes a partaker of the divine nature. When a fallen human being is inhabited in the body temple by the Holy Spirit, what does that human being become? A union of humanity and divinity, because the mighty third person of the Godhead is a divine being. Christ has given his Spirit as a divine power, because that divine power coming from the throne of God is administered through the Holy Spirit to overcome all hereditary and cultivated tendencies to evil and to impress his own character upon his church. Now, if Christ, when he was on this earth, exercised no power that he has not through the plan of redemption made freely available to you and me, then who was administering that power to Christ? The Holy Spirit. My Bible tells me that Christ was filled with the Holy Spirit. He is the second Adam. Why is he called the second Adam? Why does the Bible also refer to him as the everlasting Father? It's not calling him God the Father, our Father who art in heaven. It is calling him the everlasting Father. Do you know, the Bible is also good at giving us the answers if we will study here a little, there a little, rightly dividing the word of truth. What did Paul call Timothy? My son. Paul was Timothy's spiritual father. Christ is our spiritual father in that. As the second Adam, he stands at the head of a line of entirely new beings. Because before the incarnation of Christ into this old planet, there had never existed in the entire history of the universe a being who was a union of the creatures that God had created and a divine member of the Godhead. There never had existed a union of humanity and divinity as Christ was. By paying the penalty for sin on the cross at Golgotha, he made it possible for you and me to become the permanent temple of the Holy Spirit if we so choose. Because freedom of choice is a hallmark of the only true God. Satan takes his people captive. He does not allow freedom of choice, but God the Father does. It is, choose you this day whom shall ye serve. By buying us redemption, Christ has bought for us the potential to have a third person of the Godhead dwell in us, and as we submit our wills to the transmission of God's will through the Holy Spirit to our understanding, as we submit our wills to God through his agent, We become a union of humanity and divinity, and we have just become like Christ. And he is not ashamed to call us brethren. And he says, and I will give you to sit down with me on my throne, even as I am sat down with my Father on his throne. Can we comprehend what Christ is offering us? Do we recognize and realize what he has bought for us? What privilege! Unimaginable privilege, higher than the highest human thought can reach. You know, this mortal will put on immortality. My Bible says that immortality belongs alone to God. But we know through inspiration that the life that Christ laid down, he takes up again and gives to his people. And at his second coming, that transfer of immortality takes place. This mortal shall put on immortality, and those who are in the graves will be raised to immortality, and they will immediately all be transformed from this carnal flesh that we have now into glorified humanity. Remember, it was with glorified humanity Jesus ascended to heaven. Fallen humanity never gets off this planet and goes to heaven. It cannot. Christ himself never ascended to heaven in the fallen nature that he inherited through Mary. Fallen human nature went into the tomb and died eternally. Glorified humanity came out of that tomb. And God's messenger tells us that Christ tarried for a season on earth that his disciples might become acquainted with him in his glorified body. Initially on the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize him. In the Australian Union record of June the 1st, 1900, paragraph 23, God's messenger again reiterates, through his representative, the Holy Spirit, God, that's the Father, in Christ, still ministers to the children of men. Did you know that the Holy Spirit inhabits the Father? The Father is a union of divinity with divinity. Christ, Michael, before he was incarnate as Jesus, was a union of divinity with divinity. Because the Holy Spirit inhabits the Father and the Son. We are told by inspiration that the Holy Spirit searches out the deep things of the mind of God. God the Father wouldn't have to search out the deep things of his own mind. He would know them. But the Holy Spirit searches out the deep things of the mind of God and transmits them. That is why the Father and the Son act in absolute unity. Because the Father and the Son are both filled with the Holy Spirit. But Christ, in condescending to become a union of divinity with humanity, has made it possible for us to become like him. But he's taken humanity for all eternity on your behalf and on my behalf. We do not begin to understand what a sacrifice Christ has made for us. Let us examine the opening sentence of the following paragraph, taken from the Story of Redemption, page 13, paragraph 1. Lucifer, in heaven, before his rebellion, was a high and exalted angel, next in honor to God's dear Son. Now, what we have just read in this quotation is the rationale behind the Binitarians saying that the third person of the heavenly trio is Lucifer. You see, what did it say? Lucifer in heaven, the angel next in honor to God's dear son. That statement is used to support the notion that Lucifer, because they have dismissed the Holy Spirit as a being, they now claim that therefore the third person of the heavenly trio must have been Lucifer before his fall. The quote goes on to say that Lucifer had this high forehead, that his countenance was expressive of happiness, and his high forehead was high and broad, showing a powerful intellect. His form was perfect, his bearing noble and majestic. A special light beamed in his countenance and shone around him, brighter and more beautiful than around the other angels. Yet Christ, God's dear Son, had the preeminence over the angelic host. He was one with the Father before the angels were created. Lucifer was envious of Christ and gradually assumed command, which devolved on Christ alone. From this inspired statement, they go on to declare that it only describes two divine persons, the Father and the Son, and that Lucifer, being next in honor to Christ, was therefore the third person of the heavenly trio. What these binitarian interpreters have regrettably lost sight of is the fact that this whole inspired paragraph is clearly laying out Lucifer's pre-fall status as an angel in the heavenly scheme of status and order among the angels. Christ, on the other hand, is the archangel, which means chief of the angels. Among the angels, Lucifer was next in honor to Christ. Not in the Godhead, Lucifer was never part of the Godhead. But among the angels, he was next in honor to Christ. Let us never forget that the term angel, angelos in Greek, is a term describing a function. The function in this case being that of messenger. Christ, our mediator and principal intercessor, came to reveal the Father to this sin-darkened planet. Christ is God's principal messenger to fallen man. He is also in charge of all the created heavenly messengers who are introduced to us in Scripture as angels. In the Old Testament, Christ is frequently referred to as the angel of the Lord. And you'll notice where it refers to Christ as the angel of the Lord, you will find the word Lord always in the uppercase L-O-R-D. Every time you see uppercase L-O-R-D in your Bible, in the Old Testament of the King James Version of the Bible, the original word was Yahweh, the self-existent one. Christ is the angel or messenger of the self-existent one. Self-existent is a term that describes a state of being that goes way beyond our comprehension. We cannot comprehend a being who never has a beginning and never has an end, and exists through no other cause other than their own person and presence. We cannot understand that. However, Christ is also of that state of being, because Christ himself said, "I am." We find this in John the 8th chapter, verse 58. Jesus said unto them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am." Christ is over created angels and messengers, over them in authority. But among those angels or messengers, Lucifer, before his fall, was next to Christ in status among the angels. The next inspired statement that the Binatarians deploy to undergird their postulation that Gabriel is now the third person of the heavenly trio is found in The Desire of Ages, page 99, paragraph 1. And I quote, "The words of the angel, I am Gabriel that stand in the presence of God, shows that he holds a position of high honor in the heavenly courts. When he came with a message to Daniel, he said, there is none that holdeth with me in these things but Michael, your prince." And of course, Michael, we know him as Jesus, or as Christ, the Messiah. Of Gabriel, the Savior speaks in the Revelation, saying that he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. And to John the angel declared, "I am thy fellow servant with thee, and with thy brethren the prophets." Wonderful thought that the angel, this is now Gabriel, who stands next in honor to the Son of God, is the one chosen to open the purposes of God to sinful men. The opening sentence and the closing sentence of this paragraph are deployed in order to substantiate their claim that Gabriel has taken over from Lucifer as the third person of the heavenly trio. Once again, this position completely misses the point that this positional status of standing next in honor to the Son of God is a position of rank among the created angels or messengers. Christ's position, on the other hand, is fully clarified in the quote found in the Story of Redemption, page 13, paragraph 1, that we looked at earlier. We reiterate, Christ, God's dear Son, had the preeminence over all the angelic host. He was one with the Father before the angels were created. As to the issue of the Holy Spirit not being mentioned in these two inspired portions of divine testimony to God's people, the reason is simple. As we've discussed, the Holy Spirit fills the Father and the Son. The Holy Spirit actually also fills the heavenly unfallen angels. Let's read about it in The Faith I Live By, page 191, paragraph 2. From eternal ages, it was God's purpose that every created being, from the bright and holy seraph, that's the angels, to man, should be a temple for the indwelling of the Creator. Because of sin, humanity ceased to be a temple for God. Darkened and defiled by evil, the heart of man no longer revealed the glory of the Divine One. But by the incarnation of the Son of God, the purpose of heaven is fulfilled. God dwells in humanity personally by His Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit dwells in the Father. And if the Holy Spirit dwells in us, through Christ's mediation, through Christ's redemption, we have direct access to the throne of God. We have direct access to the mind of God. Our minds can be filled with divine thoughts through the Holy Spirit. When He is come, He will guide you into all truth. The Creator dwells in His created beings by His Spirit, the Holy Spirit, who dwells in him and searches out the deep things of his mind. Inspiration tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 10, "But God hath revealed them unto us by His Spirit, for the Spirit searches out all things, yea, the deep things of God." God's messenger capstones the above with the following inspired statement found in The Faith I Live By, page 52, paragraphs 2 through 7. She says, "We need to realize that the Holy Spirit is as much a person as God is a person." She goes on to say the Holy Spirit has a personality. I've never known a force or an emanation of power to have a personality. The Holy Spirit has a personality, else he could not bear witness to our spirits and with our spirits that we are the children of God. He must also be a divine person, else he could not search out the secrets which lie hidden in the mind of God. The Holy Spirit is a free, working, independent agency. Remember, he's an agent. He's God's representative. The God of heaven uses his Spirit as it pleases him. And you know, it pleases him to transform sinful men and women, to reflect by his grace and by his power fully the character of Jesus, who fully reflects the character of his Father. And so therefore we can reflect the glory of God. That is what the plan of salvation is all about, to restore in man the lost image of his Creator. From the beginning, God had been working by His Holy Spirit through human instrumentalities for the accomplishment of His purpose in behalf of the fallen race. The same power that sustained the patriarchs, that gave Caleb and Joshua faith and courage, and that made the work of the apostolic church effective, has upheld God's faithful children in every succeeding age. The Holy Spirit was the highest of all gifts that he, that is Jesus, could solicit from his Father for the exaltation of his people. Jesus paid the penalty so that we could receive divine power from the Father, administered by the Holy Ghost, and become sons and daughters of the living God, born again through the Spirit, who was Christ's earthly progenitor here on earth. Because how was Christ born here on this earth? The Holy Spirit shall come upon you, the angel said to Mary, and you shall conceive and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. Yeshua, Jehovah saves from sin, for he will save his people from their sin. The high Holy Spirit is the highest of all gifts that Jesus could solicit from his Father for the exaltation of his people. The Spirit was to be given as a regenerating agent. Without this, the sacrifice of Christ would have been of no avail. The power of evil had been strengthening for centuries. Through who? Satan and his angels, separate and distinct individuals, right? And the submission of men to the satanic captivity was amazing. Sin could be resisted and overcome only through the mighty agency of the third person of the Godhead, dwelling in this body temple and imparting divine power to overcome every hereditary and cultivated tendency to evil. This mighty third person of the Godhead, who would come with no modified energy but in the fullness of divine power. The Holy Spirit is an effective helper in restoring the image of God in the human soul. The Holy Spirit left Lucifer in heaven. The Holy Spirit still fills Gabriel. He's one of the high and holy seraphs who was created by God to be a dwelling for the Holy Spirit. In that the Holy Spirit fills the heavenly angels, It is through his agency that they are in contact, constant contact, with the divine mind of God. An angel, a separate and distinct spirit being, a created spirit being, can be in any part of the known universe and the unknown that we don't know about, and be in direct contact with the mind of God, because the Holy Spirit that is dwelling in that angel is searching out the deep things of the mind of God. Brothers and sisters, one day, when God's people get a hold of the truth and live it with every fiber of their being, we will draw nearer and nearer to Christ, who is the hub in this great wheel of salvation. And as we draw nearer and nearer to Christ, like the spokes, we will draw nearer and nearer to each other, and we will become like-minded. Because the Bible tells us, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And he has the mind of his Father because the Holy Spirit dwells in Jesus. And when the same mindset is in us, we will be in harmony, spiritual harmony, not only with the mind of God, but with one another. That will be the answer to Christ's prayer in the 17th chapter of John, verses 20, I believe, through 23. I got to move it. The Holy Spirit is an effective helper in restoring the image of God, the Father, in the human soul. The Holy Spirit is in subjection to the mind and will of God in the same way that Christ is. When the Holy Spirit dwells in us, he brings to us the mind of Christ. Philippians 2 verses 5 through 6 says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of none effect, and took upon himself the form of a servant. And he took upon the form of a servant forever. And for eternal ages, he serves his people. Amen. What will he do at that great table that is laid up for the redeemed after they ascend to heaven? Christ girds himself and serves his people. Can you believe what a Savior we have? There's no egotism with the divine trio. Each one is out to do good to the things that they have made.
Amen.
When Brother Wilbur Hargreaves stated in his said letter that the heavenly trio are now Jehovah, Jesus, and Gabriel, he exactly echoed a statement made by a brother Chapman in a letter written to him by God's messenger on June the 3rd, 1891. God's messenger responded to brother Chapman on June the 11th, 1891. And this letter is found in volume 14 of manuscript releases, page 175, paragraph 1 to 180, paragraph 4. I have to, by the grace of God, please help me, I have to get through this because this is vital to our discussion this morning, folks. Elder Robinson does not wish me to leave, but urges that I enter the canvassing field until such time as the conference can afford to employ me in some other capacity, but states positively that I cannot be sent out to present the truth to others until some points held by me are changed or modified in order that the views regarded by us as a people shall be properly set forth. And Elder Robinson, quoting from this brother Chapman, says there are two points. Number one, my idea, this is Chapman's idea, in reference to the Holy Ghost not being the Spirit of God, which is Christ, so Brother Chapman thought that the Spirit of God was Jesus, but the angel Gabriel being the third person. And his second belief was that the 144,000 will be Jews who acknowledge Jesus as the Messiah. 2 points. He believed that Gabriel was the mighty third person of the heavenly trio. And number two, he thought that the 144,000 were messianic Jews. Well, I would modify that to messianic Israelites, because you and I are Israelites. To cut a long story short, God's messenger said, in response, it's found in the same letter that I've referred you to, manuscript releases 178 through 179. She said, the 2 points that you have raised do not harmonize with the truth that God has revealed to me. Now, she just contradicted Brother Wilbur and said that the view that he holds does not harmonize with the truth that God had shown her. I believe that is the capstone to that particular postulation that has come from the pen of a Binitarian. I love this man. He's honest in heart, but he is deceived. And we have to carry a burden for these brothers and sisters, and by the grace of God, show them from the inspired word where the error lies. Because it is only the truth that sanctifies. So we close with a word of prayer. Almighty Father, please, Lord, help us to be submissive to the working of the Holy Spirit in our hearts and in our lives. And Lord, give us that grasp and understanding that you alone can impart, that we might take hold of the truth and allow it to transform us into the men and into the woman that you want us to be. Help us, Lord, to reflect your character and bring honor and glory to your name. Thank you so much that you save us from sin and not in it. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
We hope that you have been blessed by this sermon. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may also call us at 316-788-5559. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God bless you.